Hello and welcome to Austria, to Vienna more specifically. We are here for a conference run by DSM-Firmenich called Aqua Days. And today I'm interviewing Eduardo Yamashita, who is the Aqua Technical Manager for Latin America.
Yeah.
Hello and welcome, Eduardo.
Thank you, Robert, for the invitation.
No, well, it's great to have you here. You are an expert on many things, including enzymes, I believe.
Yeah, enzyme is something that I really enjoy to work in here inside of the portfolio from DSM. No?
Very good. Yes, can you tell us a bit more about your role and also your background?
Yeah.
You know, why are you here today?
Yeah, I started my career a long time ago, you know, working in tilapia production in Brazil.
Okay.
So that's my base, you know, my background at warm water species. After that, I work in some feed company, so that's my understanding about formulation, about nutrition. I bring this information that I learned, you know, in the production to the feed plant, and now I am DSM. You know, it's a bit different, you know, business that you are doing. However, I have this approach and the technical view, the all value chain, you know, so the feed plant, the production, and now some additive and technology that you can use in, you know, to the feed plant and the farmer.
Okay, very good. So you've been in the industry quite a long time now.
Yeah, around 70 years, around that.
Wow, okay. And during that time, and how have the diets changed? You know, have the diets, aquafeed diets, formulations changed a great deal?
Yeah, that changed a lot, you know, in the last year. For example, I told and then in my presentation, for example, the quantity of fish meal and fish oil is decreasing a lot.
Okay.
You know, in the diet, you know, if you get maybe the diet from 20 years ago, the diet's completely different from now. You know? So maybe in the future, it change more and more. Mm-hmm. So the reducing of fish meal and fish oil, we replace it for vegetable raw material.
You know? Okay. Can you give me an idea of the percentages, how that's changed?
Yeah, in the past it's around 70% of fish meal and fish oil, and maybe 2 days around 30-40% of fish meal and fish oil. In the future, that to be less than 10%. So that's a huge impact on the formula.
Yeah, huge impact. And why has it changed so much? Why has the formulation changed?
Yeah, changed for many reasons. The one reason is cost. So is it possible to keep a high level of fish meal and fish oil in the diet because the cost of fish meal and fish oil is so high?
Yeah.
The other one, sustainability. You know, it's almost impossible to use fish meal and fish oil in the diet, that's this quantity in the diet in the future.
Yeah. Okay, so great having these vegetable ingredients, plant ingredients, in terms of reducing the cost or keeping the cost as low as possible. But there must be some negative effects because fish, a lot of fish species don't naturally eat plants, do they?
Yeah, that's the main point. You know, you start to reduce fish meal in the diet, you start to decrease the quantity of amino acids in the diet. Also, you are decreasing attractive in the diet, you know, so that's a point, you know. When you start to increase the vegetable raw material, you start to increase the anti-nutritional factory.
Okay.
It's one thing that enzymes can help.
Yeah.
Also, mycotoxin level. So that is the main point. Also, phosphorus. So phosphorus is the other thing that when decrease the fish meal in the diet, you will decrease the phosphorus. So you have many points that you can work together with, use some solution that can help to solve this problem.
Yeah, so you need to make the diets more digestible, more palatable. And is that your role or is that the feed miller's role or who's in charge of that?
I think not only feed mill, not only farmer, not only the additive company, that is the problem, it's the value chain problem. You know?
Yeah.
Everybody need to try to reduce fish meal in the diet. You know?
Yeah.
That's the issue because it's not only cost that I saw and I tell you that it's sustainability way, you know, to continue the aquaculture business.
Okay, so how can you ensure that these are not new anymore, but these are the plant-based ingredients? How can you ensure they're having the effect you want on your fish?
Yeah, when you start to increase a high level of, for example, a vegetable raw material, mm-hmm. you are increasing anti-nutritional factor. You know, so mm-hmm. How can you decrease this anti-nutritional factor? Is using enzymes. Mm-hmm. For example, you have a side of portfolio phytase, and it's called hyphorios and hyphos. Mm-hmm. So these two products that you can decrease phytic acid in the diet and release the phosphorus.
And just to go back one step, what are enzymes and how do you, where do you get them from?
Yeah, the enzymes you get from an alliance between DSM-Firmenich and Novozymes. Mm-hmm. So this compound has a biotechnology mm-hmm. and knowledge to work and have this kind of solution to the market, not only for aquaculture, for other species. Mm-hmm. However, you are have some special application to aquaculture.
Okay. And you're the company is developing them in the laboratory here, are they?
Yes, you develop them in the laboratory, mm-hmm. And you can have two kinds of enzymes, liquid application, granulate application. Mm-hmm. So you have the solution for all kind of feed, pellet feed or extruder feed. You have mm-hmm. this kind of solution.
Okay, and do enzymes, does the addition of enzymes, does it increase the overall cost of feed?
Yeah, no. Depending okay. of the way that we are using. If okay. you use enzyme on top, that increase the cost. Mm-hmm. However, you have some way to decrease the cost. You know, for example, you can use a special matrix for a protease that mm-hmm. is it possible to decrease the cost of the diet. For example, okay. you can decrease between 5 to 12% dollars per ton right. using an enzyme. However, this price is depend on the cost of raw material that the feed plant has. Mm-hmm. So. You have some possibility also to decrease, you know, the cost of the formulation.
And how can you explain, how does using an enzyme decrease the cost?
Yeah, you can use a matrix, you know, so you mm-hmm. can, you know, the digestibility of the protein, the digestibility of the main amino acid that you can mm-hmm. use this matrix inside mm-hmm. of formulation program, and this matrix have a value. So if you start to use a protease, in this case that you are discussing, this value of the amino acid or protein is decreasing the cost in the diet because the protease, in this case, is yeah. released. Crude protein level, release mm-hmm. some special amino acid that's important, and that means you start to decrease the cost of the diet.
Okay, so it's digested more efficiently by the animals.
Yeah, yeah. You are in the yeah. end, you are increasing yeah. the digestion of the diet.
Okay, and what other impacts does it have on, say, the health and the welfare of the animals that are eating these diets?
Yeah, that's a good point. You know, not only welfare, because you need to think about sustainability. You know, mm-hmm. because when you start to increase the digestible of protein, for example. Mm-hmm. You can decrease the quantity of nitrogen that you are excreting to the water.
Okay.
So also with phytase, you know, if you can increase the digestible phosphorus, mm-hmm. You can decrease the quantity of phosphorus that you are sent to the water.
Mm-hmm. So, and just for those who don't know, why is it so important to reduce the amount of phosphorus in the water, for example?
Yes, phosphorus today is a main issue in aquaculture. You know, if you think mm-hmm. about nitrogen you can control the bacteria. Mm-hmm. However, phosphorus, that's so hard to control.
Yeah.
So with phytase, for example, you can decrease around 20% of total phosphorus in a diet. Mm-hmm. So, however, you need to be the substrate in the diet. You know?
Yeah.
You need to be a quantity of phytic acid that is substrate of phytase. To apply the phytase, mm-hmm. and you have this possibility to decrease the total phosphorus in the diet.
Okay, so that reduces the environmental impact of farms?
Yes, sure.
Yeah, and in a closed system, that would also improve the water quality?
Yeah, yes, the water quality. No?
Okay, fantastic. And what about the welfare of the fish? I mean, having these enzymes in their diets, does that impact them at all? Is that unnatural for them? What does that do to the fish?
Yeah, probably if you have a better quality, low phosphorus in the diet, low nitrogen in the water, right, probably sure that you have a better quality. You know, for example, you can increase the oxygen in the water and the fish can mm-hmm. have much better welfare. You know?
Okay, and reduce the impact of reduce the prevalence of disease as well.
Probably yes. You can reduce the problem of disease.
Okay, and yeah, how do presumably there's quite a few enzymes on the market, and how do feed millers and farmers know which ones to use and which ones they want in their feed?
Yes. Usually you have this approach. You know, the enzymes usually. Our business is a B2B, you know, we are going to the feed plant because it's so hard to apply enzyme in the farm condition. So, you need to guarantee, you know, a good application, you know, to then have a good product, you know.
Okay, and typically what sort of percentage of the diet would you want these enzymes to be?
Yeah, the inclusions depend a lot of the kind of substrate that you have. So you have some specific application depend of the diet of the plant, you know. Mm-hmm. So it's so hard to say the dosing now because it's different according to the formulation that I work on.
But it's sort of 0.01%, or I mean, is it less than 1%?
No, less than 0%. Less than 1%. Okay. We are talking about 75 ppm to 400 ppm.
Okay.
75 grams per ton or 400 grams per ton.
Yeah. So these are powerful substances.
Yeah, that's it.
Wow. Are you currently developing new enzymes or new applications for them?
Yeah, you are always looking for a new application, looking for new enzymes. So today now in aquaculture, we're focusing both in two enzymes, that's a phytase and protease, you know, that is. Phytase is a honozyme high phos and high foreos. Mm-hmm. Protease is a proact and proact 360. That's the main focus and enzyme that you have. Yeah. However, you have another kind of enzyme that you start to looking for and looking for results for the line of carbohydrates.
Okay, and how far down the product development line are you?
You have in the portfolio, you know, but you need to do in vitro testing, in vivo testing to check the result, you know, of this kind of enzyme. You know.
And when could these be on the market, do you think?
Probably, I think maybe 1 or 2 years, you know, to have some result, you know, it takes a time, you know, not easy, you know,
because. Yeah. But not too long, really, in the grand scheme of things.
Yeah. You have this product some countries are using. Mm-hmm. However, we need to be focused because the aquaculture is a bit different from other species. Because you are thinking about things, a lot of enzymes that you have in the market, for you are talking about three main species, you know, tilapia, salmon, and trout, also shrimp.
Yeah.
So, and the behavior of this fish is completely different.
Yeah.
So you need to choose one enzyme and go further to understand better what happened. Yeah. After that, to jump to another one. So you are doing that, you know, and protease, you have a very good result, you know, in shrimp and warm water fishes.
Yeah.
Phytase also, and maybe next step you need to looking for another kind of solution.
Okay, so those are the three main species groups that you're focusing on.
Yeah.
For the application. Okay.
Yeah.
And do you think you might diversify into, I don't know, the carps, for example, or the catfish? Or
yeah, you have some information. Pangasius also use protease and phytase. Carp also have some trials.
Yeah.
Yes, you call this kind of group as warm water species, you know, tilapia, carp, and Pangasius.
Yeah. Okay, good. How do you see, are there any particular projects that you're working on that you find very exciting or rewarding?
Wow, that's a good question. You are discussing a lot about other solution that you have that is called HiD.
Okay.
You know, if you listen about that, no?
No.
There is HiD, that is special vitamin, you know, that's a D3, active D3. Uh-huh. That you have in portfolio. So you start an investigation maybe 2 years ago and the results, it's so nice, you know, use this product, you know.
Okay.
Yeah. Now you are focused only in cold water species, trout and salmon. Mm-hmm. Launch that in Chile, very good result of sales also.
Okay. And that's likely to be available potentially quite soon?
Yeah, it's completely different approach, you know, if you compare enzyme of D3, you know, that is special vitamin D. Yeah. So vitamin D, you know, what the reason though that we're looking for the new kind of solution or new kind of vitamin D, because when you start the conversation about formulation, you know, so the fish meal and fish oil start to decreasing.
Yeah.
And D3 came from the fish oil. Okay. Almost of the three. So the fish, the formulation today in salmon is decreasing the quantity of the three in the diet.
Yeah.
So you have to supplement with the three.
Okay.
Inside of the premix.
Yeah.
And SCM launched this product a long time ago, maybe more than 30 years ago in other species, in broiler. And now 1 year, 2 years ago, we start to do some trial in trout. And get a very good result, not only in performance, you could see a result in performance. Yeah. However, you could see some bone health results, fillet yield, also pigmentation.
Okay, amazing. So that's one to watch out for.
Yeah, that is the target of innovation. That's really believe in as innovation, because not only in performance, you do have a very holistic approach.
Fantastic. We look forward to seeing that become available and more widely used.
Yeah.
And you've been in the sector a while. It's changed presumably a lot in the 17 years you've been involved. And how do you see it developing? How do you see aquaculture generally developing?
Yeah, if you get, for example, the scenario in Ecuador, in Ecuador is a very benchmark in the market when you're thinking about not only about sustainability, because thinking about the production. So we have a lot of, for example, you have automatic feeder that help a lot the feed. How can you, the growth of the farm or the growth of the animal that is going very well, this kind of technician. And also about the sustainability. If you get the shrimp from Ecuador, nobody's using antibiotic.
Yeah. So you see Ecuador's shrimp sector as being a leading light and an example that other countries could potentially follow.
Yeah, they're increasing year by year, two digits per year.
Yeah. So that's a positive. What about, are there things on the horizon that you're more concerned about?
Yeah, I think the water concern. So the problem that you have in the water, special phosphorus is an issue now. Also nitrogen.
Okay. So is that water? That's water quality.
Yes. No, water quality. Yeah. Okay. In general, I think one that also the disease. How diseases came has some issue.
Okay. Right. And if you were to give, I suppose, three take-home messages from your presentation today, what would they be?
Yeah, the takeaway message that from my presentation today, about enzymes, the first thing, you have this possibility to reduce cost of feed. So you have this possibility to use enzyme to reduce cost of the feed. So one thing that is important to measure.
Yeah.
The other one is focus about nitrogen, phosphorus that you can reduce in the feed and impact in the water.
Yeah.
So that's another message that I'd like to pass.
Brilliant. Excellent. Well, thank you very much, Eduardo.
Thank you. Thank you for the interview, Rob.
Very nice of you to come in. And good to meet you.
Thank you. Thank you a lot.